of Michigan, Pace Me, for letting us borrow their instruments, and the Filipino American Student Association, FASA. Yeah, they're representatives here at the workshop. So I'd like to introduce our guest presenter. My co-presenter is Peter Paul De Guzman. He is a World Arts and Cultures graduate from the University of California, Los Angeles, and we have done extensive field research in the southern Philippines, and his specialty is in traditional or cultural Philippine folk dances. So,
Very honored to be here this morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today looks to be an exciting day, I think, in terms of getting a lot of things done. Bernard and I are excited to share what we've done recently in researching Philippine music and dance in the southern Philippines, particularly Maranao and Sulu. And I think we had an added request for Tiboli. So we'll be doing those three today. This is especially for the students because I know you guys could use the material for possible performances and just to also enrich whatever you guys are already doing for this year. So looking forward to sharing that with you. Okay.
And so just as a disclaimer, so the title of this presentation is Dances and Music from the Muslim Societies of the Southern Philippines, meaning that the ethnolinguistic groups that we'll be covering, their religion is Islam. However, many of the traditional art forms that we'll be covering today are pre-Islamic in origins, and they're shared throughout other cultural traditions found throughout maritime Southeast Asia. So just to give you a general background of the region we will be covering in the southern Philippines is this region known as Southwest Mindanao, also known as the Autonomous Region of Muslim Mindanao. And the provinces that we'll be visiting where these ethnolinguistic groups are located are the Maranao of Lake Lanao in this region right here. And we'll be covering the music and dance genres found in the Sulu Archipelago, mainly from this island, which is Tawi-Tawi. It borders eastern Sabah, Malaysia, and the southern Philippines. So just to give you some background information about our research and who we've studied under. So it's been an ongoing learning process for both of us because as many diasporic Filipino Americans who are living here in the United States, our initial exposure to Philippine cultural arts is through Philippine folk dance and music. There are many Philippine American dance troupes, you know, that practice theatrical or traditional renditions of folk dancing. And Peter and I, we've been practicing, you know, traditional music and dances for the past over 20 years since we were like at age 10. And Peter, he's formulated his own group, Malaya Filipino American Dance Arts in Southern California. And then I've formed a Kulintang ensemble called the Pakaragyan Kulintang Ensemble that's based off of research-based material. And we both obtained our bachelor's degrees from UCLA. I obtained my degree in ethnomusicology, and Peter in the World Arts and Cultures Department. And during that time period when we met as undergraduates, we wanted to continue or delve deeper into some of the traditions that we've been exposed to from a surface level and, you know, delve deeper into learning more of the source of the material by going directly to Mindanao and the Sulu Archipelago to meet native practitioners. And so we've had the privilege of studying with Ligaya Fernando Amelbangza. How many of you have heard of her name, Ligaya Fernando Amelbangza? She is the author of the book Pangalai, Related Traditional Arts of the Sulu Archipelago. It is a pioneering book that sort of lays the foundation for studying the cultural arts in the Sulu Archipelago. And I'm also a student of a Kulintang guru who recently passed away. He's the Maguindanaoan master artist, and he was a National Heritage Fellowship awardee. He was the first Filipino-American to ever receive that award back in 1996. It was the late Danungan Sibay Kalanduyan. So all of these experiences have laid the foundation for us to conduct field work with the native practitioners. So if you can see in some of our photographs, it's We've done research in Marawi with cultural troops and master artists in the region. So first we're going to start off with the gong tradition from the southern Philippines. So we're going to divide it. The format of this presentation is we're going to start with gong music, and then we'll go into the dance portion with Peter. So just to give you some background information on gong chime traditions found throughout the southern Philippines, I'm sure some of you who have taken my Music of the Philippines 200 performance course, this is this is all second nature to you, I assume. So the gong music traditions found throughout the southern Philippines are performed during celebratory occasions for weddings, social gatherings, and rites of passage. It is also used to accompany dance that are mainly for weddings, festive occasions, and sometimes rituals. It's never played during funerals or Islamic observances because it is a form of indigenous practice that predates the coming of Islam. And each ethnolinguistic group has its own regional repertoire that is specific in terms of instrumentation and musical pieces that are found in their traditions. And then the shared musical features that you'll find are there's a gong roll instrument that serves as the main melody. There is a drum or a membranophone that plays the rhythm for the entire ensemble. And there's up to 2 to 3 interlocking gongs depending on the region that supply the drone, and a small knob gong as a timekeeper. And so many of you have wondered, how do you learn this form of music? Whenever I'm asked, after I perform, they ask me, how do you learn this music? How is it transmitted? It's traditionally an orally transmitted genre of music where different generations observe each other playing, from the youngest to oldest. So for example, a young child can sit on his mother's lap and the mother will play the kalintang melody as she is guiding the child's hand. So that's another example of how the music is orally transmitted. And notation for kalintang music is a recent phenomenon, started in the late 1970s, early 80s, by scholars at the University of the Philippines to have a tangible source and a visible notation for students to study the kalintang music within one semester. So first we're going to start off with the first ethnolinguistic group we're going to cover are the Maranao. And the Maranao are known as the people of the lake. They have their gong ensemble, which is known as the Kakulintang tradition. And the main melodic instrument is the kulintang. The dibakan is the goblet-shaped drum. The agong. The babandil, and the babandil serves as the timekeeper. And this tradition is, as I mentioned earlier, performed during festive occasions. And among the Maranao, what's distinct to this ethnolinguistic group is the onor. She is a professional female performing artist and a cultural bearer that has mastered a repertoire of kalintang pieces. She's well versed in chanting the origin stories of the Maranao, known as the Durangan Epic. And within her performance, she performs this holistic performance known as Kaganat Sadarangan, in which she sings, she performs various gestures, dance movements, which are distinct to the onor, and she plays kulintang music. So I'd like to play you an example of a holistic performance of a Maranao onor as she does the Karonok chant, which is sort of to introduce the whole ensemble and to ensure that the performance will run smoothly. And And within that performance, she has the option of manipulating various dance and hand gestures. So in this example, she will demonstrate how you manipulate the fan, which is called kapagapir. Another variant of an onor is an onor who also does the chant and the stately walk, which is known as kakini kini. She either can perform the stately walk before she plays the kolintang and then after. So here's an example of an onor performance where she does the karonok chant and the kakini kini walk.
Thank you.
So next she will demonstrate the actual protocol of playing the kulintang among Maranao Onor musicians, in which she'll test the instrument to see if the gongs are in order. The babandil, the dabakan, and the agong will test their instruments, and then she will render a piece that's traditionally played to welcome important guests entitled Kapag Onor.
Thank you.
So it's interesting to note that the performance seemed rather lengthy, you know, in terms of the Western construct of time. So what's distinct among the Maranao is they take their time in actually, you know, executing the various gestures, such as kahini kini or kapagapir, because that's an aesthetic that's found among the Maranao. Onor, which is, you know, when she's showing her beauty and grace in a timely manner, you know, the audience will appreciate that more as opposed to like rushing things. So that's the aesthetic among the Maranao. And then since traditionally the kulintang is a woman's instrument, oftentimes what happens is the onor, you know, she will display her skills on playing the kulintang amongst, you know, a group of men playing the dabakan and the agong, as considered which are considered masculine instruments, and at times they try to outdo each other when playing the kulintang, or showing off their skills in playing the agong to impress the kulintang musician. So how do we move this here? Okay, so I just wanted to demonstrate some the compositions found in the Maranao repertoire, and then eventually have you all try out the instruments. So first, I'd like to ask Gyan and Peter to accompany me on the dabakan and agong. So to demonstrate the playing of kapagonor and then the whole holistic performance. So throughout the Southern Philippines, each musician has their own style. I'll have you play the dabakan, Peter. Has their own style or rendition of playing a kulintang composition. So the melodic framework stays the same, but it's up to the musician to improvise their own rendition of a piece. So I'll be playing a version of kapagonor that I learned from my kulintang musician who studied Maranao kulintang music while he was a member of the Darangan cultural dance troupe, and he was surrounded by many Maranao musicians who taught him this piece, kapagonor. So first, I'll start with playing the ka'anon, which is the melodic rift, to ensure that each gongs are in order, followed by the dabakan and the agong, testing their instruments, and then we will begin from there. I'm going to teach you all the basic accompanying patterns by dividing the groups up into three. So
This group right here will play the babandil, which is the timekeeper. And the agong is actually divided into two parts. There's the penang isa, which plays the consistent rhythm. And then there's the pamulasan, which is the interlocking pattern. Played together, so sounds like this.
Thank you. for the dance portion, let's all take off our shoes. Yeah. Just put them under your chair. I think the first thing I'm going to do is teach the kini-kini. The kini-kini is primarily a woman's movement, but men, you're welcome to learn it. All right, everybody, shoes off. Everybody's going to dance. Okay, and then what we'll do is, the space is kind of tight. So, I'll ask everybody to come away from the chair into the empty space here. Can we move into the back?
Is the mic on? Okay, so the kakinikini. There's so many versions of doing the kakinikini. Okay, there's not just one. But you have to remember that this walk is a refined walk. It's used to enter the ritual. As you saw in Dr. Bernard's video, the Onor did the kakinikini before she played her music. It's also a traditional way of dancing. So it's used for so many things. So it's a gesture that's quite simple to do, but we add a lot of wrist twirls and other gestures to make it a little bit more complicated. So
simple, but it's done with a lot of class. So let's do it now facing this way. And I'll be here. And you're going to travel and walk while you do it. It goes forward, the wrist rotates, and we paint the wall. Step back with, I will glide back with the right hand as you step forward to the right. Right hand flips, and you step forward to the left as you glide. That's simple. Now, when she starts to dance with her malong, here, we like to dance with counts all the time. Over there, they don't count. So let's count it as 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. And 1, 2, and 3, 4. Take the wall on 5, 6. Now, I'm going to add some detail. When you step forward, you're going to go ahead and slightly lean and look towards the right. So, and lean and look towards the right behind the shoulders. 1, two, look forward three, four, nice and smooth. Paint the wall and turn and twist towards the right. One, two, three, four, five, six. Okay, your hand has to be as light as air. Okay, very light. For those of you who came to the Pagalay workshop yesterday, quite similar in terms of the detail of the hand, right? I think what I'd like to do now is to pass out the malam to people so we can learn in different ways. The men and women wear the malam, and then we'll dance using the timbre. For the women, the men will also dance using different moves. So the malams are here. So, I'm going to have...
We have several here. Okay. We're making more room.
Let's have the gentleman wear some shoes so you can see them.
Go ahead.
Okay, so what we'll do is we'll rotate. By the model, we're going to we'll trade them.
Yeah, trade, because we don't have enough.
Okay, so step inside your model. Okay, yeah, you have one that's not connected, so it doesn't have to work with it. Do you know they're really, you know what, let me trade with you. That's a big one. And you know what, they are really big in the model now. So,
can you guys hear me? Is the microphone on? Okay. So, I want to say the Maranao Malong is really big. What we are using right now are Indonesian batik prints, but the malong that you saw that the woman was wearing, where it was panels of stripes, it's really big. So if you guys feel like these are huge, don't worry, you're going to be able to use them. I'm going to show you how to first do a wrap, okay, for ceremonial wear. There's so many types.
Side, then you're going to go ahead and grab it with your elbow, okay, over to the other side, and then tuck, make sure it's tight in that elbow area, then you get these curves.
That's okay. There you go.
We really have a guy here.
All right, everybody. So you had it at your elbow. Okay, you had it tight and taut. Okay, you fold it two ways. If your malong is long, you roll it over. Okay. If it's short, you just tuck it in. Okay? Yeah. And you want to make sure that your ankles are covered. Right? So that's why the malongs are really long. In the traditional Maranao, it's so long that it covers your whole body. You can use it as a blanket, a sleeping bag. I was surprised when I first came across how big they were. Sun shield, right? They're made into bags.
Hammocks for the babies.
Hammocks for the babies, that's correct. So many uses. Okay, so now, you saw that when we were dancing, when the lady was entering during the kinikini, she was holding her malong, right? And it's a noble, there's a noble way to wear, to hold the malong while you're dancing. You're going to untuck your malong, gather it towards the left, pinch it on that left hip, gather it always with your elbow. They always gather it with the elbow. And then let it just fold over the forearm. Okay, and most of them will walk around just like that, because it's easy for them to adjust the malong for any situation, whether they're walking or sitting down, right? Mm-hmm. Anything, playing music, okay? So this is how we'll do the kakinikini. So let's all face this wall. I'll start here, okay? Are you ready? So we're going to take the right hand, right there. And you're going to go ahead and step, slide back with that right hand. One, two. Go ahead and drag it down. Bring it up, forward. Twirl in that wrist, and you paint that wall down. Good. Take a step. It's a simple walking movement, but you're making an elaborate hand gesture to emphasize the movement. Good. Again, and a count. One, two, and three, four, paint, five, six, and one, two, and three, four, five, six. Okay, hand has to be as light as air. Let's review that wrist rotation. So in the Pangale workshop I did yesterday, I focused on strong hands here, flexed hands. They don't need to be so flexed in Maranao. It just needs to be smooth. Okay? Just smooth. So when you do that glide towards the back, just smooth forward with the rotation and with the wall painting. Yes. Just light. Exactly. Okay, so let's learn some more movements with the malong. A bag, okay? A bag to pick chilies, because they like hot, spicy food in Marawi. So they will take that malong, again, pull it towards the left, take your elbow and pinch it into the side, okay? Extend that malong, take that part of that, the malong right down below where you're pinching it, tuck that into your elbow, and now you have a bag. There's your bag. Okay, so now you can gather
gather the chili, right? We could put a choreography to that, a movement that they do. So let's use our right hand. They pick chilies, what else? They pick the calamansi, let's say, the different fruits that they use for their, which one?
Marang.
There you go. They'll probably get like two or three fruits. Okay, so we're going to use our hands. We're going to rotate the wrist, one, two, and put into the bag. And rotate, pick the fruit, and put it into the bag. So the dance step is going to go, you're going to step with your right foot. We're going to go step right and step out with the left, back with the right, point your left foot, and hold. Okay? One more time. So let's face the monitor, please. Step, cross over with the right, step out with the left, back with the right, point with the left, and hold. Okay, let's put a count to that. Let's face the front again, and go cross. One, two, three, four, hold, five, and six. From there, let's add the hand gesture. So, and I'll go here. So we're gonna reach for the fruit, and one, two, three, put in four, five, six. Towards the other side, cross with the left. Since the left is already crossed, just take a step out into the towards the right side, and with the hands, one, two, three, four, five, six. Yep, repeat, and one, two, three, four, five, six. Last time, and one, two, three, four, five, six. Yeah. So you're picking chilies too. But you're going down towards the ground. And the men's bag is quite complicated. So can we trade a malang with this gentleman, a full one? Yeah, the long ones. You guys need to use the long one. Let's trade with the long one.
Yeah, this one's really long.
And ladies, you're always welcome to learn these bags as well. Okay, so we start with the open malong. Got it. Okay, so you have to shrink this malong down. So you're gonna shrink it like this. And there you go. Yeah, I'm pretty much wrinkling it up into a... Yeah. Okay, he has to. Okay. So get it to this. That's going to be a tight pack. Okay, so here we are. Pull the malong towards your left arm. All the way out there. Take your right hand and dip it in and pull the back. Good. Twist it to the other side. So from here, you're here. Twist it into this. Take this. Yep. Take this. Tuck it into the belt that you've made. That's it. That's it. Yeah. That's just to make a seal. And there's your sack right there. Yep. That's the sack. Open it up so that you have a sack. There you go. So now you want to open that. Yeah, you want that to stay in there. There you go. That's it. Yep. Okay, there's our sack. So from there, you're going to... Did you go ahead and take this there? You're going to pull this under.
Mm-hmm.
All the way there. Okay, take this one. This one that you have right here. And tuck it into your belt. Till it's taut and tight. Uh-huh, you can release this hand and then open this into your sack. Yeah, yours is a big one. Oh, so you can take that and just tuck it in.
Oh, okay, now I have a big sack.
Okay, so let's do it again. Ready? So pull it out. Let's do it again. Practice makes perfect. Because believe me, when I did this, I had to do it like 20 times before I remembered it. I took a lot of time for me to get that down. All right, so first, wrinkle it in. Wrinkle it up. Good. Pull it out. There goes my mic. Okay, so you pull it to the left. We grab under with the right hand, the back loop. You pull that back loop over to the other side to make this X pretty much, this crossed belt. Take that same band that you have on the right hand, tuck it over. Make sure this is taut already though. And tuck that in. Or else your chilies will fall out of the bag. Okay? Tuck it under, and you should have a nice tight belt. And then you fix your bag from there. If you have a hole, which the bigger the malung, you probably will have some space. Just tuck one of those in, and there's your sack. There you go. That's a nice one. Okay, so the motion, the movements for the men. Yeah. The men's movements. The men's movements are like this. You're going to bend down, and we're going to pick the chilies in the sack. Very simple movement. Good. You come on up. Other side. And kneel. Because we're going to put this together, and the men and women will dance. Okay. One, two, and into the chili sack. Okay? So let's do it together. Let's have the women do their bag and the men will do their sack. What's that? It's practice. You'll get it. So go ahead, pull it out. We all have to start together with the long malung. Who wants to have this one? Miguel should take this one because the men's malung is really big. Okay. All right, open up your malung, hold it out. Let's have some music. You just you just put it into the elbow. Right, tapos yung ano, right there, that one. Tuck that into. There you go. That's it. Okay, so we're just going to step right and left. Okay, have your malungs open. Let's play the music. Just right and left. And right. Point. Left. Right. Left. Okay, here we go. Men. Way up. Women, just hold it. Keep going, men. All the way, keep going. Keep going, Edward. All the way up. Ready? We're going to start doing the bag with the movement. Go, and one, two, and three, four, five, six, seven, eight, tuck, ten, keep going till you finish. The bag.
So you put it there.
Yeah, you're there. Hold that. There. Gentlemen, ready? Okay, ready? We're gonna do the movements. Five, six, I'll do the girls first. Seven, eight, and one, two, three, four, five, six, and one, two, three, four, five, six, and one, two, three, four, five, six, last time, one, two, three, four, five, six, the gentleman's moves, five, six, seven, eight, and one, two, three, four, again, one, two, three, four, stand up, switch, and one, two, three, four, last time, one, two, three, four. Good. Okay? Thank you. All right, so we learned how to make the bags. How much time do we have? For the Maranao?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Any questions on the malong, the bag? Okay. So you play with that choreographically. You guys, the counts are a little different for the gentlemen, but you can, I think for the sixes, if you do, you know, you'll be able to even it out if you do a certain set. Or you can change the counts as well. Okay? Let's do, now I hear myself. Okay, so let's do now the ceremonial malong for men and women. The women have so many uses. It's so beautiful, actually. And there's one movement I didn't get to teach the women. Can I borrow a malong, please?
Here.
Yes. Okay, this is actually, you know, while the men were shaking it and getting down with their malongs and making it into that belt, the women actually have a way of presenting the malong. It's really beautiful. Here's how it looks. Okay, you take this malong till it's at about your chest height. Okay? You pull it over towards your right till your left is pinched into your hip. Okay, you take that right hand, just pinch the malong, extend the fingers, that's the aesthetic. You reach that hand up and you brush your face with it. Okay, so it's a movement that goes one, two, and three, four. We take it to the left side. One, two, brush, three, four. Okay, so again, very delicate movements. Let me do it in front of you so you guys can see. So we're gonna, and I'll travel with it. So, there's those long malongs. And one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Almost like you're brushing your face. One, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. So your angles, this is all angling actually, your angles are cross body angles. That is the pattern that you're following with your hands. So when we pull it towards our right hip, and actually here, let's start like this. Take the malong and bring it forward, like that. Pull it forward. That's going to give you a little less malong to work with because you're going to actually increase the amount that is on the side here. Okay, from here, let's pull it towards the right. Pinch it with your arm to close the malong. We don't want it to show anything below. Okay? Now do the cross body line with your hands. Cross it from your right ear to your left hip. Okay? You're going to need the full length of the cloth to do that. Okay? to your left hip. Yeah. Open it now to the left. Take a step with the left foot. Take it from the left ear and cross body to the right hip. Okay? And step right. It should flow nicely. Right hand to that left hip. And left. And cross. Any questions? Let's do this. Let's do this. Take your malungs. Let's not even worry about the pinching. And I just want you to go right. Okay, let me face this way. Take the right and pull it towards the left. Left up and pull it towards the right. Again, right and pull. That's basically the motion. Left and pull. Okay? So now the only difference is you're tucking it in to your sides. Towards the right, I tuck it and close that so it's tight, and I draw that line towards my left. I look towards the left. Yes. Take it out to the left now. Pull it towards the left ear, and I look towards the right. Yes, draw it down. And step right, pull it out to the right, and cross body line. Last time, pull it out to the left, and draw that diagonal. Yes. Okay, we're good. I want you to try this. Because you don't have a complete malung, right?
No.
Okay, that's why. I was wondering why. Here you go. Try that. I'll take that. I see it. Okay, so I'll teach two more movements, two more malungs. We will do the ceremonial wear for the men first. So, Migs, where's your malung? Or is that a malung there? Oh, okay. Thank you, Tita. Kasi malaki po to eh.
Yeah, natatapakan ko
nga. Oo nga po eh. Pero ganun talaga. They're really big. Okay, so. So guys, here you go. If the men, you want your malung back? There you go. Because from here, you're going to take it over to your left again. Pinch it towards the left. Okay, over towards the right side. Okay. Ooh, this is long. Hold up. There you go. And it's big. Okay. And I can either leave this here or I can make another fold. Okay, so now you have this nice panel in the front. Again. Okay, so you're here. For the tight ones, all you're going to have is enough to go over once, like that, and then just fold it over. Okay. You always want to make sure that your malung covers your ankles. Okay? I know. As you practice it, when you practice this, you'll start to know the length that you have to have before you fold it. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. Okay, ladies, let's do your ceremonial wear. So, you can take this malung. Ladies, here we go. I'm going to teach your ceremonial wear of malung. So if you have one, let's use it. You're going to take this towards the left, pinch it on that left side, and you're going to drape it over the shoulder, and you're going to pinch it over with your, you're going to keep your left hand tight, and it should cover all the way up to the chest. So yeah, that one's going to work because it's long. There you go. Okay? Just simple. I know, the short ones are going to make you look like you're wearing a mini skirt. Yeah, so that's why when I first saw Maranao Malungs, I was surprised how long they were. They're really long. This one, she looks good. Everyone take a picture. It looks good. She got the line. In the traditional Maranao Malong, there's also a landap, this panel. So it's really a part of the design, but it's always in the back because it covers the back for the sake of modesty.
Does it make a difference level, right?
Yeah. You can put it on the left or the right. It has significance whether you're single or married. I think you're married. They wear it on different sides. So you probably, there you go. Okay, there's other ways to wear it. So you can take that. Okay. So when we dance it, we're going to dance this together next, gentlemen and the ladies. You're going to choose which ceremonial you want to wear at the very end of the dance. There's that. There's a drape over. Okay, so there's the one where you're going to take it. And again, towards the left. Okay. And then we're going to go ahead and fold it over the chest. Okay, and then you're going to make sure it's tight and fold under. And it's kind of like a muumuu. This one's more commonly known. Okay. There you go. That's me, right? Okay, so let's put it all together with the dance.
I like the muumuu.
You like the muumuu one? It looks good on you. Okay, we'll put it all together with the dance. So so we'll call it basic one will be our kini-kini. Basic two will our next movement. Yeah, the kini-kini. Okay, the gentleman will just walk with a heel and step and left and step right and step. Okay, very simple. Okay, our next, after the kini-kini for the ladies, we'll step, everybody will step right. Okay, take the malong to the right, step towards the left. Okay. And we're going to start the bag. So you'll take the bag, ladies, pinch it with your elbow, pull in that extra piece of cloth, and open up, and there's your bag. Gentlemen, you have to speed it up. One, two, three, four, five, six. Open it up. Seven, have it ready. Eight, okay? The best way you can do it. They can move also, okay? Bahala na kayo sa choreography. You can go in a circle, you can go in a line, whichever one you want. Okay? After that next move, okay, we pick the calamansi or the chili. So ladies, okay, pick those and put it into the bag. Gentlemen, we come down to our knees. Let's go ahead and, ladies, let's do it four times. Gentlemen, we're probably going to do it six times, okay, because our counts are different. From there, we stand up. Everybody takes their malong, and we go back to our extended, where we open up the malongs into a full spread, and we'll go into our ceremonial wear. Okay, ladies, you have the two choices. You can either do the malong draped over your left shoulder or your right shoulder if you're married. Or you can do the muumuu, which is, you know, it's not the term for it, but that's what it looks like. Okay, crossed over, rolled up. Gentlemen, you'll do the ceremonial wear by taking this over. And actually, I'm going to change this for the gentleman. There goes my mic. I'm going to add a detail to the gentleman because most of them won't wear it this long anymore unless they're the elders, right? They will wear it shortened.
So you'll take this, cross it over, tuck it in. Okay, then you'll take the center, and you'll tuck it into your belt, and you'll wear it like this. Take this, yeah. Yep. And tuck it into your side. And you want to have...
But men have pants.
Men have pants. Men have pants. And women wear tights under now. Or loose-fitting pants. Yeah, they're not exactly, you know, bare under anymore. That's why the rule is you cannot show your ankles. As long as you follow that rule, you should be okay. But if you have the tights, that's what you wear them for. Just in case it rises above, you got that extra layer of modesty.
The pants is something like this.
Yeah, loose pants. Yeah, solid color.
Like panja, looks like panja.
Yeah. Okay, so gentlemen, you want to have this, when you do that, you want to have this diagonal. You want to have that diagonal in the fold. Okay, then we're going to exit. Very simple. Gentlemen, you're just going to walk with your hands crossed, heel, and step. Women, you can take your malongs, and you can do the kini-kini with the dress. So if your dress was like this, this is what's great. The kini-kini can be applied to any movement. You can take your malong. Hold up. That wasn't very pretty. Let's take this. And you can take the malong and just step and walk, still with your aesthetic, with the fingers and the pinky extended, and exit. Okay? You can, if it's the mumu and it's tucked, kini kini. You can do the kini kini with the mumu. Okay? All right. So let's try it. Let's have fun. We'll start with the walking. Ladies, you'll start with your walking like this. Oh, no, we said kini-kini. Sorry, the kini-kini. Yeah, that one was kind of hard. But you guys should learn that because that's really pretty. Okay, ready from the start. We'll start with the ladies into the left side, pinched with the elbow, and folded over your forearm. Very regal. Gentlemen, we'll start off with your malongs just as ceremonial wear, without the fold. Okay. And are you ready? Okay. Gentlemen here. Ladies here. Let's just all face the circle. We'll travel in towards the circle so we can see each other. Let's open up here. We have more space on this side where I am. Ready? Music. And 5, 6, 7, 8. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Repeat 2 more times, gentlemen. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Ready? And take your malongs. Let's make the bag. Right. Ladies, you're going to take it to the left. Pull it. Back. I was doing the gentleman's. Here we go, gentlemen. Keep going. And cross. Ready, begin, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, continue 2 more times, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1, 2, 3, 4, again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6,
time. And what? I forgot. Share your chili with your friends. There you go. Yep. Some interaction. Okay. Okay, ready? And now we're gonna pull it. Open up your malongs. Spread them. Right. Left. Right. Choose your ceremonial wear. Ladies, take it to the left. You put it over your right. Okay. Here we go, gentlemen. Malong. Okay, take the left, right here. Okay, we're gonna exit, ladies, and one, two, rotate. Good, just play with the cloth that you pull it out, exactly, and then pull it in. Exactly. Take it back. Yes, that's it. Use your malong.
I have to hold it.
Yeah, you can hold it. I know, they're a little tight. Okay. Gentlemen, we exit. One. Okay. That's it. All right, very nice. There are unlimited uses of the malong. It can be turned into a blanket. I'll show you a couple more. Okay. Mm-hmm. It could be used, it could be made into a robe for the gentlemen. The gentlemen walk around. Okay. Another type of robe. Around. So there's lots of ways. There is a way of, but that, I think that's more a patong. So you would twist it. And then you can put your water jug. Okay. There's that. There's also a hood. Okay, you can wear it like this. What else is there? There is, I'll show you, there is a sunshade. Right there. You can cover yourself if it's raining. Okay. So yeah, there's lots of uses. I showed you about five or six. I'm sure you'll find more on the internet, on YouTube. Okay, so when you're making your sequence of movements, you know, you can tell a story. You can tell a story of them waking up, going to the gardens or the forest to pick what they're going to eat, preparing the food, and then going to the ceremony in the evening. You can tell a story with how you wear the malong. Okay, traversing the town and getting cover from the heat or whether it's raining, you can play with those movements. And always remember that the basic is just the simple kinikini for the ladies, okay? And the step for the men is just the right step to the left step, okay? In a moment, or in maybe half an hour, we'll do the sagayan, which is the men's ceremonial dance. And that one's gonna be fun. So hang in there. All right. I'm good, you're ready? Are we doing sagaya now? Are you done with? Yeah, I think we should. Okay, everybody, I think we're done for the malong dance and the Maranao kulintang portion. We're gonna go ahead and give you guys a 10 minute, just a 5 minute, because it's probably gonna become 10 minutes. a five-minute break if you'd like to take this time. I don't think it's enough time to food, just for a bathroom break and drink some water, because we got one more dance I want to teach and tire you out before you eat that meal. Okay? Because you can't do this dance on a full stomach. Thank you.
I don't know.
Turn this on. Did you learn a lot there?
Yeah.
Dami pong movements.
Oh. I forgot to ask some of my friends to bring the malong, but these are
okay. Okay na po yan.
Okay. Yeah.
But you know, if you have a chance, gumawa po kayo ng mga malong. Kasi stripe lang po yan. Kung pili kayo ng tela pang asin sa hindi na. Kasi yun ang like the real Maranao malong. And then yung tamang sukat sa mga
yan.
Ano lang po yan? Yung hanggang na lang po, if you stick your elbow down, ganun lang po kalapan dapat. Ganun lang. Pero from your ankle hanggang ulo. And then, just plain cotton. Panels.
Tapos may ano dito.
Apo na, may design sa gitna. Your cotton could be, usually it's in the shade of green, emerald green.
And yellow.
Gold, yellow, at saka, or mango yellow, at saka yung maroon. Yung tatlong kanilang favorite colors. Combination of only two of them. So most of the time it's always gold and maroon, or green and maroon.
I have a authentic
Maranao malong.
Maranao, mm-hmm. Green and maroon.
Yes, it's green and maroon.
Silk.
Yes, they made them in silk.
And it's very old.
Yes. Oh, gayahin niyo lang po yon.
A student gave it to me.
Yes.
From Maranao.
Wow.
She's from Maranao, so she gave it to me.
Gayahin niyo po yun. Ito, kasi ito medyo malalapad or they're too
okay,
small.
Okay, I have that. That's very
ano yeah.
Ano yung antigo.
Antigo na po. Mm-hmm. Yeah, dude, let's review right now because I haven't danced it since. Thank you.
walk through the middle section. I have a picture of a Sakya dancer. The woman can sit down, or they can dance. They want the gentleman to come up. Of course. Sure.
Does on my collar here. I thought that was the feedback from the
going back and forth.
Hello? Test. Okay, so our last dance I wanted to share with you is the Sagayan. And the Sagayan is a ceremonial dance for the men. And it's done for so many occasions. It's done for ceremonies. What else? It's done for.
Traditionally done before going to battle. So
yes.
Sure that they won't get hit by any bullets.
Okay. So in the times, in the past times, it was done a pre-war dance, and they would chant a song for protection, and also a song that would decrees their loyalty and their bravery to fight till the very end. Okay, so it's a very noble dance. But in modern times, it's used for ceremonial purposes to start the royal entrance, for example, into a ceremony, into a wedding, a parade. The Sagayan dancers always lead the procession. And really, the dance is improvisation. But there are fundamental movements that we broke down when we learned this in our last research trip. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to teach you guys the fundamental movements. And then when we do the dance with the music, I think I'm going to do an improv without all of the accents. It's all of you are going to, just like we did in Pangalay last night, have the opportunity to improvise.
and you'll travel around the room. The dance is quite physical, and traditionally, the man enters into a trance and into a frenzy, okay? So it's a crazy, sweaty dance. So in other words, you get out of it what you put into it. If you give it your all, you're gonna sweat and faint. Or you can kind of be more concentrating, meditative and concentrate and focus. You have a sword and a shield. Sword on the right, shield on the left. Here's my shield. Trey, okay? So we're going to step right. Step forward with the left, lift. A slight lift with that heel of the, with the heel of the right, and step down and lunge. Good. And step out. Step forward into it. Okay, one more time. So, the whole thing, and one, lunge. Okay, good, come up. From here, step up and reach the right foot up and heels up with the left and lunge. And it just continues with that motion. I know we don't have much space, so let's do two, and two into the center. One, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, okay? It gets complicated with the sword. And the sword sweeps, one, two, three. The head's gonna whip back, sharp, four. And step, shield wields forward, and the head whips back the opposite direction. Okay? Right? So, ready? Let's do just two of them. We only have room for two. And one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Make those head, we can call them the whiplash. Make it sharp. Step right. Bum, bum. Yeah. Step right. Lunge left. You look towards the left. Mm-hmm. Bum. Over your leg, yeah. Bum, bum. Bum, bum, bum. Bum, bum. Yeah, that was correct. So let's say the leg that you are lunging with is where you will turn towards with your head. Okay? Let's do it with the music, that first two moves. Bum, bum, back, back. Bum, bum. One, two, three. Bum, bum, bum. Hold up, I'll do it with you. Ready? And go. Bum, bum. Bum, bum. Bum, bum. Bum, bum. Okay? You hear it in the, you'll hear the accent in the music. I think the count is, go again. And one, bum, one, two, three, four. Bum, two, two, three, four. Five. One, two, two, three, four, five. One, two, three, four, five. Hit one, two, three, four, five. 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 Five, six, seven, and one, two, three, four, five. Two, three, four, five. Two, three, four, five. Two, three, four, five. Okay? Okay, then, that's just the entrance. I'll teach about two or three more basics. So now, let's call this the get down and groove with it, because you just kind of you shake the shoulders, shake the shoulders. Okay. Okay. Now with those shoulders, you're also shaking the shield and the sword. Okay. This is where you got to show your swagger. Right? Okay, the footwork, you're gonna step out, You can turn. Okay. This turns into a leap. Okay. Okay, that will be our two basics. So it's turn. You can just step, and then you add a hop. Okay, let's do it from the top with music. Okay, ready? From the top, we'll do it twice. And then you're going to get down and do, we're going to improvise in that next, the second basic. You can do it either right to left, or you can hop with it. Just be aware of your surroundings. Ready? From the top. 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2. Ready? Go. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 2, 3, 4, 5. Again. Last time. Ready? And 1. Go. And 1, 2, 3, 4. Add a hop, and. Last time. There you go. Okay, then, this one's simple. This one is easy. It's a step hop. Okay, but you have to, you're gonna take your shield right in front of your, about, say, chest, neck level when you're stooped over. Sword, pointed. And it's a step, beat, step, beat, step, beat. You can make a circle. You can circle with a partner. So, yeah, you have to make that beat heavy. You have to put weight into that beat. So step and put weight into it. 2. Weight into that beat. 2. And look into that shield. Or into your cell phone. Okay? This has a lot of variations. Stay right there. Jake, stay there. This has variations. If you're dancing with a partner, you can strike each other. Okay? You can strike with each other. You can make a circle for the four of us. And step. Put weight into that beat. Weight. Yeah. Okay. All right, so we've got three basics. Did I promise four? Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Okay, so our last one. Ooh, okay. Our last one will be a leap into a twist, into a knee turn. A lot. So it's twist. So you can do this. You can do this. You can do this. So slowly, slowly. Take a hop. Open. Keep your legs where they are. Just twist and fold the knees and land. Okay, come up, lunge down, and turn on the knee. 1, 2, and come up. Yeah, So this can be done. You can do this when you're making an exhibition. Let's say there's three Sagayan dancers. Two of them will kind of step back, and the other one will come in, you know, and do that exhibition. You can do both ways. You know? Okay, so let's do it from the top. Or no, let's do that again. Ready, ready? Last one, last time. And then we'll do the dance from the top. Ready. And from the beginning. Oh, no, sorry. No, let's do that last one. Let's try it. Ready? Yeah, with the music. The one with the jump. Just stay in place. Ready? Jump in place and... Good. Open. Twist. And sit. Into your... And up. And let's just go into the center. Slide. And slide. That's it. And up. Okay? You can add turns to that if you want. From the top. From the top, Bernard. One, two, three, four, five. One, two, three. Ready, go. And one, two, three, four, five. One, two, three, four, five. Two more times. And. Basic two. One more time. Add a hop. Here we go. Yep. Two more times. And then we quiet down and make a circle. Right? And let's all walk out. Okay, ready for the last move? We're gonna hop in place. Ready and hop. Open, twist. And up. And kneel. All right. And then you can end. You can, okay? Yeah. All right, very nice. Woo!
half of our presentation, we are going to head to the Sulu Archipelago, which I mentioned earlier are the strip of islands off the coast of Southwest Mindanao. And the culture we'll be learning about for this next hour and 40 minutes will be the Tausug, the Sama and the Tausug cultural arts. And the picture that I have here on this slide is of a Tausug Tagungu ensemble. So the gong chime ensemble that's found throughout the Sulu Archipelago, the term is Tagungu music. And the main melodic instrument, notice the change in the spelling of the gong chime instrument. It went from Kulintang to Kulintangan. The gandang is a two-headed drum. And in this picture, they actually use an indigenized wooden snare drum of Western vintage called a tambol. The bua and bulakan is the agung pair that provides the main melody, or the main rhythm to the interlocking patterns of the agung. The bua is the short rim gong, and then the wide rim is the bulakan, and the agung tunal functions as the interlocking agung pattern to that gong trio. And then the solembat is the timekeeper to the ensemble. Or the tungkung, which is the highest kulintangan gong. So, yeah, tungtung or solembat. You can remember it as tungtung because it's on the slide. So, the kulintang repertoire or the gong ro ensemble repertoire among the Sama and the Tausug ethnolinguistic groups is divided into music for listening or musical overtures called magtagongo, and then music for dancing or mangalay. And the piece that I was playing for you earlier before we were about to start this presentation was Lisag Panagnaan, which is a piece played to start every festive occasion as the guests are entering before a wedding, or the term for the wedding is magkawin. That's the term found and the Sama-Tausug ethnolinguistic groups. So the way you can distinguish between music for listening and music for dancing is music for listening is at a moderate tempo. It's much slower, and it's played during processions and as guests are entering, as I mentioned earlier. And then the music for dancing is livelier and much faster, because what we're going to learn later on through our dance instructor, Peter, is that in the Pangalai dance aesthetic, it's the faster the music, the slower the dance movements. So, Lisag Panagnaan is the musical overture, and it's played in a moderate tempo, as you can see in this video. So this is actually a video clip of a Tausug musician who plays for a cultural troupe called the Tambuli Cultural Dance Troupe, which was established by our mentor, Ligaya Fernando Amilbangza, to highlight the traditional arts of the ethnic minorities found throughout the Sulu Archipelago. So this is a picture, or this is a video clip of my Kulintangan teacher, who's a Tausug from Holo, who is the main primary musician with Tambuli Cultural Dance Troupe, playing Lisag Panagnaan.
bua are on three of the agongs, the bua pulakan, and the agong tunggal is this vocal bowl. Tik 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 gong, tik 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 gong, tik 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 gong. Let's all say that. Tik 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 gong, tik tik gong, tik 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 gong. Simple, as long as you remember the catchy vocal bones, you'll be able to play it. Angela!
Thank you. Kill, which is a generic composition, which is faster and livelier in tempo. And the tonkil has a distinct melody in which there's an up and down, ascending and descending pattern that's played on the midsection of the kulintangan. And then the sixth gong plays a constant drone, so it's sort of like pat your head and rub your stomach if you think about it. So this is a melody for tonkil. Or the playing of the tong tong and the solemb, or the tong tong and the gandang are similar because they're all playing that accented tumble pattern. So just think that that pattern, that tumble pattern that I just taught you, is just in the tempo is increased just slightly. Thank you. Archipelago, and they're performing what's called a Pangalai Ha'agong, in which the Pangalai dancer dances atop the agong, agong instrument, while the male musician continues playing as she dances. So here's an example. Particular to show that dancing and music is a symbiotic performance where you really can't have one without the other, and then the musicians function as both a dancer, and then showing how like the subtle movements that we'll learn later are grounded, as you can see in the Pangalai dancer's footwork. So, and her postures. So now we're gonna try learning how to play the tongkil. So the simplest patterns would be the solembot and the tumble, since they're both played at the same, playing the same rhythm at a lively tempo. So we need a volunteer for solembot or tongkil or tongtong. Drum, the tumble, snare drum. So the same, both the solemba and the tumble are playing the same pattern.
Keep them up so that they can play for
Motong Seal. Yeah, so
So whoever plays for a tonkil, please come back. We can be the company.
You can strut back if you want.
Oh.
I'm going to demonstrate the Pangalai dance form from the Food Archipelago. We had a workshop last night as well on this, so I know some of you are familiar. Like Bernard said, the movements of Pangalai are very meditative and contrast the quick tempo of the music. There's also the aesthetics of the dance focuses on the various postures and shapes made by the hands. Right. Images are portrayed, emotions are expressed by the hands, and oftentimes the dancer enters a very meditative state during the dance. So, Pangalai.
Okay, so you're going to demonstrate?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
So today I'm going to focus on the bird, the lingisan dance. I think I did some of those movements so you can see them portrayed. And just a little bit of a background on Pangalay before we start. So Pangalay, as Tita Ligaya researched it, she was able to find a similar word in Sanskrit, which means a temple of dance. In the modern day language of Tagalog, Pangalay means to gift or to offer, make an offering. Yeah, Pangalay sa iyo. So it's a dance that defies the rapid tempo of the kulintangan, the gonggo ensemble. And the aesthetic of the hand and the postures of the body are the most important essence, is the most important essence of the dance. They must be refined and well defined. You have to be able to see the image clearly, the lines, and all of that. As you saw in the video, there's different styles of Pangalay. The style I'm going to share with you is the Amilbangsa method. Ligaya Amilbangsa was able to live within the towns of Tawi-Tawi, and she gathered some of the dancers and saw the materials that the performances that they would have for local rituals and weddings, and she would practice in her home, and she pretty much took all these movements and started to create a vocabulary. So families would not have a vast variety of vocabulary. They probably have one or two favorite moves that they would do. She ended up combining them and creating a dance called Lingisan. So that's what we're going to learn today. We're going to learn the movements of the bird. Lingisan is like a seagull, although it's a different species that lives on the coast of Tawi-Tawi. Okay, so like the flight of the seagull, the first movement we'll do is called the figure eight. Let's start with a little stretching, though. Little stretching for those hands. You're going to take your right hand, I'll take my left here, you're going to flex the toes of fingers up toward the ceiling, and you're going to take the index finger and the thumb of the opposite hand, you're going to fold back those fingers while maintaining the flexion in the wrist. Good, you should be stretching your forearm muscles here. Good, then we're going to pump the elbow up towards the ceiling without moving the shoulder, isolating the elbow. One, it'll look like this, two, three, four, just some warm-ups and stretches. Five, six, seven, eight, yep, nine, good, ten, hold that. Good, and release. Feel a little bit of length in that muscle there. We're gonna do the other side. Take the right, flex the fingers up as well as the wrist, and you're gonna hold them with your index finger and thumb and flex up. We're gonna take the thumb and fold it forward. And again, pump that elbow up into the air. One, two, good. Three, isolate the elbow from the shoulder. Four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, and 10. Good, okay? All right, that was key because we want those fingers from freezing up. So now we're gonna go ahead and learn the figure eight. You're gonna be making two independent figure eights with your arms, one on the right and one on the left. So we're going to take that right arm, we're going to brush it up with the wrist. Again, like you're painting against the wall, you're going to rotate the wrist, palms, facing forward with the fingers flexed up, and then you're going to paint that wall down, leading with the wrist again. It continues in the back and creates a small circle, leading with the wrist. Again, it rises up, leading with the wrist always, rotates upward, and you paint the wall. Continues to glide back, leading with the wrist, you make a circle inward. Good. Let's do it with the left hand. Here we go. So you're going to glide up, leading with the wrist of the left, rotating, palm of the hand faces forward, it glides down. We draw a circle inward with the wrist leading. One more time, and up, fingers rotate, upward, and down, and follow that circle back. Good. So now the challenge is to combine both right and left, and to keep the patterns even across, even as you move both sides. So let's keep the left hand out here. Don't have to move it yet. Let's focus on the right. You're going to take that right and lift it up. You're going to complete that circle. Once you draw the circle in the back, you're going to take that left hand and bring it up. Complete that circle. The right hand is still moving. And draw the right hand up. Good. And continue. And you're making two figure eights, right? One on the right side and one on the left. It's kind of a lopsided figure eight. The movements in the top are much bigger than the circle at the bottom. You can visualize that. Yeah, very smooth. Exactly. And if you liken it to walking, it's kind of that action of just swinging the arms as you were to walk. Now here's the difference. In the Bangalay technique of Amil Bangsa, the same hand and leg move to take the step forward. It's not the opposite. Okay, now the Bangalay that I've seen, they do the opposite. But in her style that she's researched in the back in the 60s and 70s when she was there, it's the same arm and same hand. So take a step with the right, take that right hand up, and then you're going to brush down as you lunge down and bend deeply. Good. And then take a step with the left. Left hand goes up, and it brushes, and you lunge low. Good. One more on either side, right? On the right side, sorry. And last one on the left. Continue, because I want to see what you're doing. And here we go. Right side. Inhale up there. Exhale down. Breath goes with the movement. Inhale as you rise. Exhale. Good. Keep the feet smooth. They never lift the floor. We're on the right. Good. Exhale. And left. Feet just glide forward to take that step. One more on the right side. Inhale. Exhale. The breath is going to control your movement's tempo. Good, and relax. So automatically, by just doing the basic Bangalay movements, you get into a very calm state, right, with your breath. And whenever your breath relaxes, then your body relaxes, right? So it's a very entrancing dance. In fact, this dance is not performed. It's done in rituals and practiced for hours at a time. Sometimes, I mean, during the midnight, rituals, they'll dance this all night long, you know, so very meditative. So let's go ahead and do it with the music. So I want you to hear the contrast of speed and tempo with the movement. Play it fast. Can you play it fast, Bernard? Can you play the tempo fast with the ana, the thumbul, so we can go extra slow? Yeah. 5, 6, 7, 8. Thank you. Very nice. So we can use that as our movement to enter the stage. Usually, or the performance space, the dance is performed solo or with partners. And it would be danced in a wedding ceremony or for rituals. And a solo dancer would come in and they would just take their spot and they'd like to show off their own personalized movements. So one would use those movements to enter the stage. You saw the lady in the video was doing something similar. She was doing something like this, okay? But has that type of form where the movement continues from right to left and is an infinite movement that does not stop. It's very circular. Okay, so let's do our first bird movement. One more thing, actually. Let me backtrack. Your posture. You notice that the posture of Pangalay is always bent forward. When you bend forward, it's natural to kind of bend the knees so that you can carry that weight and balance it out. Okay, the chest is still slightly arched up, but the rear has to be lengthened in order to support that back. This is actually great physically. I'm a Pilates instructor, and we teach people to strengthen and lengthen that lower back. This automatically makes you work that back and the abdominals. So they're both working to support you. And then you got the added quadriceps working, and of course the glutes holding it all together. Come on up. So it's a great, yeah, as opposed to, let me tell you, as opposed to ballet, you're upright, right? This could be unnatural for the body. Okay, you have to tuck, but this is a very natural way to bend. Okay, very natural way to bend because you're working all the muscles, you're not having to tuck anything, it just lengthens everything. All right, so each time you take that lunge forward, you're going to bend into that angle. Even when you stand up, you stay bent because you're going to go into that lunge right away. There's never a fully upright position, okay? That is the posture for Pangalay. Let's do our bird movement. So go ahead and make a circle around me. And yeah, let's make a circle. You're going to go ahead and extend your fingers long with the wrist flexed. Mm-hmm. We're gonna grab the marbles. This is a traditional exercise that the Ligaya does. You're gonna grab the marbles with your fingers. You're going to go ahead and curl those fingers, and then you're going to throw the marbles out. Grab the marbles, curl the fingers, and extend the fingers and throw the marbles out. Good. Grab them and throw. This is very important for us to warm up the hands because the eagle in particular has so many shapes, or the linguisa, sorry, last time. Good. The next position you'll make with the hands is the beak of the linggisan. You're going to take those hands. You're just going to bring all the fingers together. You want to have the flexion in that knuckle to produce the beak out. So not curved, but flexed. And there's the head. Yeah? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Flex that. Bring the fingers in. There you go. And there's the flexion of the... Okay? Thank you for helping the little ones there. All right, so think of this like, you know, when you're at night sleeping and you're right by your lamp in bed and you're making those shapes when you're a kid. Very similar. Making these shapes, projecting these bird beaks, right, as a shadow. Okay. So that's a bird beak. So you can literally take this rotation with the hands, unfold it, or rotate it outward, and then flex it into the head of that bird. Okay? To produce the imagery of a bird pecking, you just pump at the elbow. Okay? From the elbow, the hands are just stationary while the elbow moves the forearm, okay? Now, to make the feathers, okay, you release those fingers and you're going to flicker the fingers. All these subtle movements create an effect. You can flutter, right? Or flicker. Okay, so let's make our first bird image. Let's do a pangalay offering. I taught this last night where you're going to offer by rotating the fingers down and then offering outward. From there, you're going to continue the motion by making the bird's beak with the left and the feathers under the head. And there, we're going to peck and we'll flutter the fingers nice and slow. Very slow with the fingers. And there's your bird. You can do it on the other side. However, to get it on the other side, you don't just change the position. You have to have the connectives. Let's go back to your pangalay offering. And then go into the beak with the right and the feathers with the left. And peck with the right, flutter with the left. Flutter should just be slow. Just relaxing. So doing that with the motion and the posture, I know it's a lot to think about. So you would be in this bent position. There is a rise and fall in the movement. So you can go inhale and exhale. As you fall, you're creating the image. And then you can hold that, flutter, and inhale. Make the offering into the bird's head, feathers, and flutter. Good. One more time on the left, and inhale. Exhale. Inhale. And exhale. Good. So connecting that to your figure eight, which we can assume here is like the flight of the bird. So let's all do figure eight on the right side, left side, into the bird, left. Sorry, I'm a lefty, so I always start left. So start with your right. I actually am ambidextrous. I do weird stuff like that. Right side. Oh, we can start left. Left. And then right. And then go into the offering, into the bird. Offering into the bird on the right. Okay? And then we can improvise from there, and I'll have you guys do solo numbers. Okay, ready? I'm kidding. Here we go. Ready? Take a deep inhale in place, and start with the left. Inhale. Want to play some music for us? Even if it's just a quick time? Good. Thank you. And shapes with the pangalay. I want to show you one more bird shape. Let's do the turn. It's a workout. So how do we turn or move with and glide smoothly? You really have to take small mincing steps. So I'm going to take my right foot and turn it out because I'm going to lead and turn towards my right. I'm just going to pivot small take your time. You're not rushing a turn. If you misstep and start to take your foot outward, just bring it closer. You have all the time to turn. Okay, to turn the other way, same thing. Just angle the left out and rotate, mincing. You'll find a way to turn. You want to turn without shaking the booty. Yeah? You want to just, and again, that comes with you bending the knees and just holding steady. Okay? So, we'll make the bird by, I think I did this transition earlier, just take that, you just finished the figure eight here. You're going to scoop, make a wide offering with the hands. One hand will do the bird's beak. One hand will do the feathers. And you'll just hold it out like that. The beak into the body of the bird, into the feathers. That's the, you're part of that bird now. We'll lean into the bird's beak, like our head is part of that. And you're going to turn towards the direction that you're leaning. So if you're leaning left, turn left, wherever you are. And go. Bend your knees and turn towards the direction that you are bending. Good. And come out of it by taking those hands into a wide offering again. And create the head and the feathers. Lean into the opposite direction and rotate towards that direction. You can peck, but peck smooth, nice and gently. Good, one more time. And flex. There's no stopping in between. Everything has to flow. That's the beauty of Pangalai. It's an infinite dance. When one performs, everything connects and flows into the other. Last time, inhale, exhale, and rotate. Good, and I like to end everything with a nice Pangalai offering. Okay. And you're probably sweating buckets like I am. And all we did was three movements. Okay, but it's the control, like Christiane said here, that really makes you tense the muscles and utilize the full body. Everything has to be tensed, and you have to create that shape, and you have to maintain the shape in order to really see the clarity of the movement. Otherwise, you know, it looks rushed. It could look rushed, or it looks, the form is not there. Okay, so take the time when you're practicing these for the students and for the adults as well. When you feel like dancing Pangalai at nighttime on the full moon, to look at your shadow or look at yourself in the mirror. And the great thing about it is you just take your time and sit into that movement and just check yourself out. Do I look like a bird? Are my lines fluid? You know, is my neck broken? Is it connected? Okay, yeah. And that's how you start to create the aesthetic of Pangalai. So let's play some music. Let's do all three moves. And then at the end, I think I wanted to do a contemporary, build a contemporary piece so you guys can kind of see how the direction where Pangalai can go. Here we go. Yeah. Thank you. Workout.